It's a great thing to be in church. First service was very eventful. We had a full service. We had a communion, a baptism, a choir performed. So, yeah, you need to join the church. A very spirit-filled first service. So I hope you came ready to praise our Lord and glory in our community. Greetings, rise, if you're ready to worship. In Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ, be with you. All right, this first song is about being proud of our birthright as children of God.
Started pulling away from the first service. So that's, and that's problem to have, short on parking on Labor Day weekend. The announcements for this Labor Day weekend, one of the things is that it is Labor Day weekend, and that means the office is going to be closed tomorrow. And then the next part of this note that I was to read says, if you signed up for Meals on Wheels, please meet at the Lutheran Church at 10 a.m. and not 10:30 a.m. So for anybody who signed up for Meals on Wheels, now I thought that was Tuesday that people met. Does anybody?
It is Tuesday.
It is Tuesday. Okay, so I just want to make sure that this didn't make people think it was on. Yeah, so on Tuesday, 10 o'clock at the Lutheran Church on 7th Street. Then we also, another thing we've got going on because of the time of the month it is our gospel circle. First Wednesday of the month, 6 to 7 p.m. at the Social Hall. And all singers and acoustical instruments, welcome. So that's a lot of fun. I haven't been to it for a while, but I miss it. Another thing that is, we're kind of getting back in our normal schedule now with school starting back, vacation times going, and so forth. And one of those things is that we have our Bible study restarting for the first time in a while on Tuesday night with Pastor Carlos at 7 o'clock. So, yes. Yes. So we're happy for that. And we've also got our Bible Pathways class that meets at 2 o'clock down the hall on Tuesdays. And then Bible Pathways class at Thursday at 7 o'clock at night at Wendell and Susan Moore's home. So another couple of opportunities to get into the Bible and let the Bible get into you. Amen?
Amen.
And then, let's see. I want to draw your attention to the Pavilion Landscape handout. Pavilion nearing completion, but we've still got landscape to do. Isn't it nice that we're not doing landscape now with absolutely no moisture, no rain, no anything? So I'm sure that once the drought is broken, that will be taken off better. And then the other handout I wanted to mention was the Christmas backpack items and the Hope collections for missionaries. Everybody see that in back there? If you didn't get that, you can pick one up on your way out. It's there on that little music stand kind of thing, or a podium, I guess is what I should say. All right, well, with that, I'll turn it over to Troy for Youth Ministries.
All right, well, welcome everybody. Church Online, thank you for joining us. Like, subscribe, tell somebody where you are right now. Let's do the first one. Just a reminder, this coming Saturday, men's breakfast. Right? That's here. That's here. So men show up to do that one. I heard a word that we need jams and jellies. The Good Sam is running short and we need to put some stock back into that one, so if you can remember to do that. Wednesdays has become quite an exciting adventure. We're launching the theater and drama team for the elementary and middle school kids, so if you're interested, know somebody, you could come and be a sheep. That was an inside joke. So Wednesday nights for that youth Bible study is from 6 to 7, and we have some fellowship from 7 to 8 on Wednesday nights, trying to get it all to align on that one day. Mondays, we still do have some kids coming over for music lessons, learning video, getting into computer type of things. So if you know a youth that would be interested in that, send them this way. We've got some great things coming up for that. Thank you.
All right, so with that, may pay the, oh.
I forgot one. The biggest.
Are you out of your gourd?
Yes, I just was a little bit out of my gourd. And I borrowed that one. That wasn't mine. We have a sign up in the back. People are already signing up for a shift. Monday through Fridays, 4 to 7 p.m. Saturdays, I think it starts at 8 or something, goes throughout the day. They're two to three hour shifts. But if we can get ahead on having the sign up done, then we can start planning around the events that are happening on those days with those who will be volunteering. So we're expecting a good crowd. I think the drama theater is going to be performing. We have an elementary middle school kind of black light dance. It'll be inside of here. The youth band will play. That'll be quite an exciting thing on the 29th, which is the last weekend of the Marigold Festival. We'll have about 7 hours of music out here. So we'll be having some of the bands that we had last year, like Bobby Mack, Rebecca Hendricks, and some other groups that will be joining us on that day, as well as our youth band. All right, thank you so much.
Troy, this one's for sure.
Troy, yes. When is the truck showing up? Because that's when we need help too.
Say again?
When the truck shows up with the pumpkin.
Yes, October 1st, Sunday, like last year, right after church, the truck had pulled up, and I think we had about 40, 50 of us that would stay. Just come back, help us get the pumpkins into the deal. We'll have the pallets ahead of time. I'll kind of mention that a little closer, how we can be a little bit better organized as we were last year. Thank you. Back to you, Bob.
All right. Well, may the grace and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And I'll turn it over to Pastor Carlos.
Okay, very good. One thing we need to pray for is rain. Okay, so listen, there's going to be some of us gathered together Monday through Thursday at the courthouse at noon, some of us, and tomorrow I don't think we're on vacation because of Labor Day. But praying for rain. We need rain. So one of the most important things, though, is remember we want God's purpose and glory to be accomplished, and then we need rain. Okay, keep our priorities straight. So let's pray for rain. Lord, in your mercy.
Yes.
Amen. Okay, as far as other, it seems like I was supposed to announce something. I can't remember what it was. So let's just go on with prayer. It's kind of like when you go to Walmart with a whole list and you forget, and then you leave, and you got stuff you didn't need, and then you remember everything on the way back, right? And say thank next time. And so you apologize to your wife, and just don't say, if you want it done right, do it yourself. Don't say that. So, okay, other concerns that we need to pray for. Right now, Shannon is visiting Jason. She gets to do it on Sunday, so that'll be for just the next couple Sundays. We need to pray for just for that transition. And hopefully there's going to be some changes that are being made. So let's pray for Jason and for Grady and for the Owens family. Lord, in your mercy. And if you want to write letters to them, let me know and we'll get you the address. If you want to write him a letter, a card, something to bring to his day, that would be really, really good. So let's pray for that involvement. Also, there's a Kairos at the end of the month, the 20th or so of September. And some people from our church will be part of that. So if you want to participate in a Kairos by making cookies, you can make cookies. They just have to be a certain size and shape and consistency, no files or anything like that inside. But if you would like to participate in any way with a Kairos ministry, we can get you connected. There's a lot of different ways to do it. Just let me know of your interest, and we'll get Paul to visit with you on that Kairos ministry. Let's pray for that in preparation of it. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
What are the concerns we have this morning that we need to pray over? Yes.
Kovar.
Let's pray for the Kovar family. And with Brandon, in particular, Robert and Paulette, in just the transition. And as you know, he's was sentenced to 5 years, minimum 2.5 years. We just pray for God's grace to be in that. And just keep in mind the danger of driving in the middle of the night, and if they think that you've texted ever,
you could be
be in trouble, because that's kind of what they thought. So that's a scary thing. So let's pray for the Kovar family. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Who else and what else do you pray for? Are you pointing? Are you? I'm sorry, Alicia. Perry Denning with a recent cancer diagnosis and for the entire Denning family as they walk this path together. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
I spoke to a friend this morning whose daughter, Amber, and grandchildren are homeless and in a very unsafe situation.
Okay, let's pray for those who find themselves homeless in unsafe situations. Pray for God's grace and provision and direction. And for families and for support structures. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
And that's going out on me. And that's this one, right? Which is weird.
Just did it once.
I'm going to switch to this one and see what that does. See if that makes a difference. Okay. Okay. What else? Any other? Yes, ma'am.
Pray that our family that doesn't know Jesus comes back to Jesus.
Amen. For our families who don't know Jesus to come back to Jesus. And let's be particularly praying for health needs for Joffrey and for God's healing of him. Lord, in your mercy.
Your grace.
Brenda, did you have one? Cancellations on any procedure that you're having. So for this Wednesday, she has the dreaded after 50-year-old procedure both ways. You know what I mean? So we want to pray for her, and if it happens, well, whatever. Let's pray for Retta and for those with the procedure job. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah,
okay, anybody else? Yes.
Just for our brethren who are in a persecuted situation.
Absolutely. We have brothers and sisters that we're working with, the Christian church, that are in harm's way. Nigeria, Pakistan is the closest to us, but there's a lot of persecuted Christians around the world. Let's pray for them and their ministries and their witness. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Let me do a praise real quick. This morning at first service, we did a baptism for Dakota, one of our newest members, and he stands about this tall, and he got so excited. and that was just pretty cool, just the baptism we did. And next week, Sunday, we're going to have baptism here, and we'll have our horse trough. It's not ours, but we'll borrow one. And we'll have a horse trough here set up, and we're going to have, can you think of anybody who's going to be baptized? Can you? Oh, there's Okay, and so we're going to be celebrating baptisms next week, and we're excited. So if you've never been baptized and want to talk about it, we have water. Come on, the water is fine. Okay, so we'll be glad to do it next week. It's going to be just exciting as if our family comes and makes that profession of faith and a celebration with us. Okay? Okay, yes, ma'am.
The Mulvaney's this week.
Oh, the Mulvaney's will be traveling this week to have a procedure for David. And I won't get into the details because he's real private and stuff like that. But it's something to do with the carotid artery and seeing if it'll be my path and stuff like that. So that's pretty detailed. So let's pray. I know. Let's pray for David and Olivia. Olivia does not guard that information like David does. So they're married. They said, I do. Well, there you go. So let's pray for them. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah,
who else? Yes, sir.
There was a student at TCU who lost his life suddenly last week.
Okay. Do you know his name?
Wes.
Let's pray for Wes, the family. Wes's family, a student at TCU, passed away suddenly. Pray for all that means in the family and that network. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah,
anybody else? Okay, I think that's it. So let's bow our heads and let's pray. Lord God, you are so good to us. We are so grateful for your amazing grace, the way you work in our lives, your faithfulness. Lord God, we lift up every need and concern to you. We pray, Lord God, for those who are struggling with the loss of a child and or a family member, and those who are struggling with families in stress. And we pray for your provision. We pray for healing, direction, encouragement, and comfort. I guess our biggest prayer, Lord God, is that we would realize that you're with us and somehow you're working in and through these things. Give us the grace that we need to endure. Give us the grace that we need to trust. Give us the grace that we need to walk with you as you walk with us. We now pray together, Lord God, for the need that we have in this part of the country. We pray for rain. Lord Jesus, we have no way to provide for ourselves. And we pray that your provision will come in such a way that it'll be seen as an act of God and the grace of God. So our trust is in you and you alone. We now pray for each other, and we pray over every congregation that's meeting today. In the name of Jesus, we pray for an anointing on the preaching of your word, an anointing on the worship of your name, and for your presence to be felt. We pray for the church of Jesus Christ, every Christian church and congregation, to become vibrant, to be filled by your spirit, anointed, and empowered to be your witnesses at the end of time. May we glorify you as things are coming to a conclusion and your purposes are being fulfilled. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Okay, church, we invite you. I think, praise God, for our three faithful, the three amigos. Okay, I can tell you. I'm going to invite you to stand and let's just worship God and give him the praise he deserves. Feel free to get something to eat because Brian said it's informal, so there you go.
Oh, And forgiveness. It's always my
Heavenly Father, you are amazing, Lord. It is a joy just to be in your house and to revel in your presence. We are so grateful, and you have so much love and understanding. God, you are so vast. It's amazing to think that the same God of the Bible, the same God who was there in the beginning, is here with us right now. And Lord, you never change. You are a solid rock. Outside of time, outside of influence. You never change, yet Lord, there is still so much. There is always more of you. So Lord, we just gather here in this fellowship. We ask that you bestow upon us that word that will lift us up, that word that we can carry out so that your will be done. We serve such a great and powerful Lord. What an honor just to play a small part. Father, have your way with this service. Break down our walls. There's no shadow that you won't light up. That just shows how much love that you have for us, Father. So at this time, we turn our hearts to you. We praise you, we love you. In your name we pray.
Okay, the kids are dismissed for children's church. All right, let's all stand for the reading of God's word from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. Now Moses was pasturing the flock of Jethro, his side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed. So Moses said, I must turn aside now and see this marvelous sight, why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. And he said, Do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said also, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters, for I am aware of their sufferings. So I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Amorite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. Now, behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians are oppressing them. Therefore, come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly I will be with you, and this shall be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God at this mountain. Then Moses said to God, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God, furthermore, said to Moses, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial name to all generations. And then from the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a name and a living way, which he has inaugurated us through the veil, that is, his flesh. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds, not forsaking our own assembling together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Right, would you bow your heads with me and let us be an attitude of prayer. Almighty God, we pray you speak to us the word that we need to hear, that we have grown our faith and our love for you and discover the greatness of your love, your purpose, and your plan for us. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Okay, I'm actually excited about preaching this sermon, and I'm hoping and praying that it's possible that you can hear what God is saying to you today. Let me just tell you something. This isn't part of my sermon, but I just really said it. The word stupid is in the Bible. It said, don't be stupid. Okay? God is speaking. And the question is, can the people of God hear the voice of God and realize he's saying something to us and he's got a plan and a purpose? Is it possible that we can be on holy ground and not know it? Is it possible that God can be so close to us that we don't feel it? The answer is yes, it is. And the scripture is filled with that. And so my prayer is somehow God will speak to us and we will see God and experience God in a fresh way and get excited because God is doing something. And it's like he's praying that his people, the church, will wake up and hear and see what he's doing. And I'm not just praying about this congregation. I praise God for this church. Man, I praise God for you guys. This is an awesome church. I'm praying over every congregation. Christianity needs a fresh flowing of the Holy Spirit. And we need to realize God's got a purpose and a plan. Now, let me tell you something. God is at work, and we may not know it, and sometimes we don't realize it. This whole thing with the Owens family, and I didn't bring this up in the last service because this is us right here. Listen, Jason's got a call, man. He's doing Bible studies. His life is going to be changed.
Amen.
He will never be the same. He's got a call to ministry. Grady has a call to ministry. He's leading praise and worship. Somehow, in the midst of a tragedy, injustice, Satan will never win.
No, he won't.
His greatest victory, Satan's, was the cross. God's greatest victory was the cross. Okay, now let me just say something. God's working in and through the things that we go through. And I'm just excited about what God's doing. But we have to get over our lack of understanding. And there's a farmer. There's a TV show called It's a Miracle. You can watch it for free on TV. In fact, Diane's going to probably have a little get together and watch different series of It's a Miracle. Because there's a story of a farmer, and you can watch it for free online. You don't have to have it. It's not cable or anything. There's a story of this farmer has his cow. He's milked his cow for 5,000 years. It's a great cow. It's a good relationship, you know. But one day, old Bessie, whatever the cow's name was, pinned him against the milking post and kind of broke some ribs or something. And the cow's never acted like that before or since. But because of the injury, he had to go to the hospital. And when he went to the hospital, the doctor gave him x-rays and discovered he had cancer. And if they hadn't caught it, then he would have been in trouble. I mean, so they're thinking, he's thinking, oh man, thank you. Thank you, Bessie, for having a fit and showing me this. Now, you can say, that's just a coincidence. Let me just tell you something. I just believe in a God who works through things to establish things and get my attention to do something. I believe God is a God who's got a purpose and a plan. Yeah. And let me tell you something. He uses imperfect people. And you might be sitting here saying, yeah, but Pastor, you don't know what I've done. Yeah, I've got... Let me just tell you something. God doesn't want the Christian to be caught up with guilt and condemnation because of what you've done in the past. He's not condoning sin of the past. What he's saying is, it doesn't belong between me and you. I love you. And that's why Jesus Christ came. Listen, this whole sermon is about the cross.
Amen.
Okay, let me get to it. Everything is based on the cross. Listen to what it says in Psalm 103. This is pretty cool. It says, he has not dealt with us according to our sins. Praise God. He doesn't deal with me according to our sins. Or rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Now I want to point out two things just on this. First of all, God wants his people to know how much he loves you.
Right.
For you, it's sad when Christians, because of some failure or some weakness or something of the past, or you just think, oh, I'm just unlovable. God just, no! He's not going to let your short-sightedness, your wickedness of the past get in the way of his love. He loves you. It's beyond his heights. You can't even comprehend it. If you could just comprehend how much he loves you. And he loves you so much, he separates your sins from you as far as the east is from what?
The west.
The west. Not north and south. That's limited. North and south is limited. East and west is eternal. But I want you to catch this concept of east and west. Because I believe in Scripture there's mysteries hidden there that are consistent. That God wants to separate your sins from you as far as the east is from the west. And I picture it, him taking it to the east, running and running like Forrest Gump in football. Remember? And he kept running and running. Just keep running. And he's trying to get it away from you. He doesn't want you to go after it. Because he loves you.
Amen.
So I want you to capture this east and west concept. Because there's a mystery hidden in here in Scripture. And then I want you to figure out something. He says he takes our transgressions from us. Okay, right there in the middle of that verse is the olive top. It's the Christ marker. We're going to talk about this. I am so convinced that the Aleph and the Tav, these two letters, are the center of truth and reality. I am so convinced this is the key to what Israel needs to understand of what the Aleph and the Tav are, so that they will have the revelation and their eyes will be opened up. It's a Christ marker. It is a covenant marker. The Aleph and the Tav is right there. There is a journey that we're going to take to discover the purpose of God, but the very Aleph and Tav is the bullseye. It is the center of God's purpose. From the day you're born, you need to come to the cross of Christ, and that's what the Aleph and the Tav represent. It represents Aleph, God, Tav, cross, covenant. God's covenant. God's covenant is central to everything. Jesus dying on the cross is central to all, the Old Testament, the New Testament. No, not even only that. To the very beginning of all things. and is the center of time, is the center of purpose. You want to find God's purpose for you? You need to get saved. There you go. It didn't say anything about what church, denomination, how to worship, how to do communion, how to get baptized. It says, you need to come to Jesus. That is the very center of all truth and reality. Jesus on that cross. The olive in the top. Now, the Jews, rabbis said, we don't even know what it means. If you read in the Hebrew, it's not translated. They just say, well, it's a mystery. And one day, when Messiah comes, he's going to tell us, this is a hidden mystery in the mind of God. Well, we believe Messiah did come, and he did tell us. And he said, I am the Aleph and the Tav. If you quote it in the Greek, you say, I'm the Alpha and Omega. But he's Jewish. He said, I'm the Aleph and the Tav. The beginning and the end, the first and the last. Everything is summed up in Jesus. Now, I believe that the Aleph and Tav are pointing to the cross. Okay? Now, let me just tell you something. That's God's purpose. But it's very possible that you could be called and destined to the mighty purpose of God and for you to not realize it. Moses is a man who was born. Born, and listen, a Methodist can say the word predestined. When you talk about Moses, he was predestined, man. Before he was born, he was called to be the deliverer. I mean, they're killing babies. Mama doesn't want to kill him, so she puts him in a reed and throws him into the Nile River and lets him float, you know? I mean, it's symbolic of Noah, the ark, you know? And then he's floating, and Pharaoh's daughter sees him and grabs him and takes him in and adopts him, and you know the story. But she named him Moses because she drew him out of the Nile River. Let me tell you something. That's why she named him. Talking about a terrible thing in his life. Terrible event in humankind and political upheaval. Killing babies. There's a prophetic name or meaning behind his name. Moses means to draw out. And guess what? God called on him to draw out the children of Israel out of Egypt. He was called to be the deliverer of God's people. See, it's more than what you're going through, your circumstance, the terrible circumstance that you're in. It goes beyond to something cosmic, something that's more powerful. And yet there's something even more powerful than Moses and the children of Israel. Something that goes beyond not just Moses and his name and Moses drawing out the children of Israel out of Egypt, but it goes to the fulfillment of the Aleph and the Tav of Christ on the cross. It holds everything together, the very purpose and plan of God. Okay, so part of it is a wilderness experience. All of us are going to have to deal with wilderness experiences. But Moses is raised at the age of 40. He thinks he can deliver the people. That's what he feels called to do. And all of a sudden he catches his vision and he tries to do it. And at the age of 40, he ends up in his attempt, killing an Egyptian, running for fear. Pharaoh's going to kill him, and he's a broken man. And he spends the next 40 years as a broken man taking care of someone else's sheep. Let me tell you something. One thing I've discovered living in church parsonages, it's one thing to mow my own grass and another to mow yours. I'm just telling you. There's one thing for me to take care of my own property, and there's another thing to take care of somebody else's. He's taking care of somebody else's sheep. Yes, he got the daughter, but he got a bunch of sheep he's got to take care of. And he's a broken down man, a failure, no fulfillment, 80 years old. Don't you ever think that 40 years in the wilderness of brokenness was 40 years that flew by quickly. No, it was a terrible experience. But let me tell you something. It is during these times that God is doing something. A diamond, all a diamond is a lump of coal that is put under tons, extreme pressure and extreme heat for a very long time. And after all that process, someone finds it and sees a treasure in it. And then in the skilled hands of an artisan, it is cut. And it's polished, and it's sold for a lot of money, because it's a treasure. You will never see the diamonds of God's glory in your life without going through the wilderness. There's just no shortcut. So when you're going through something, at 40 years, man, that's tough. God wants to bring us there. He wants to bring us to that brokenness. Steps towards that revelation is when you have a personal experience with God. It's what Moses had with the burning bush. I mean, he had to step aside. He had to be willing to leave the sheep. Think about it. He left the sheep to go and behold something. Are you willing to step aside and leave the things that you usually, the mundane, the routine, the things that hold you back, are you willing to leave them and go and see what God wants from you? And that's what he did. He stepped aside and he had this experience. I am so convinced of one thing Troy's been preaching. Every time he preaches, he says these words. Without revelation, there is no transformation. And unless you have a personal revelation of God, to where all of a sudden, I mean, it's like when I made my commitment at A&M to Jesus, and I went to church, and all of a sudden, I could hear the sermons with New Year's because I could hear. I could hear God. There is a God. And he's speaking to me. And it's so clear. And something changed in me because I had the revelation. And it was in that revelation I finally found the transformation of God. We've got to be willing to do that. This burning bush is not consumed. And the neat thing is, in his revelation, he realized God knows him. He knows his name. Moses! I wonder if God told him, no. Pharaoh's daughter didn't name you. I named you, son. Because I purposed you. She just thinks she did that. Moses, I know you. I know what you've been going through. I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Man, I'm your God. I know you. And I know your suffering. And I know the suffering of the people. I know your brokenness. And I'm here, man. You know, when it comes right down to it, it's divine timing. Let me tell you something. God does not operate on your clock. When I first fell in love with Jesus, I remember praying for things, and I asked God for an answer to prayer. And I would say, Lord, would you help me? Give me patience. Now. You know, that's part of the problem. God doesn't do that. He's got a purpose and a plan. And even Moses' presence took 80 years for him to be there, to be fulfilling the deliverer prophecy. So that very timing of God, God told Abram before he even changed his name to Abraham, he said, Abram, I'm going to take you and you're going to be strangers in a foreign land and you're going to be a slave and you're going to suffer bondage and it's going to be 400 years. 400 years, ain't tomorrow. 400 years is something. And he said, but then you're going to come out and plunder and don't worry. I'm going to bring judgment on those nations. But I've got a purpose. The iniquity of the Amorite hasn't run its course. I've got to let it run its course. It's going to take 400 years to happen. Let me tell you something. That tells me something. That one, you're part of my plan and purpose for eternity. And two, it's not about you. Because you're going to be dead before all this comes about. Church, you need to hear that. Prosperity teachers, preachers tell you, if you believe in Jesus, you get that parking spot. Let me tell you something. Sometimes God says, you're fat, you need to park over there, and you're going to walk. He's never said that to you. He might have said, you're going to walk. Okay, let me tell you something. Sometimes we go through hardship. And you say, sometimes you think it can't get worse. I've been there. Have y'all been there to where something's going on? You don't have to explain it, but. And you say, it just can't get any worse. I'm, yes, it can. Yes, it can. The church one time that blew up on me, I could not believe it. I thought it was a perfect church. And then just all of a sudden, I discovered that there were demons there. And I said, it can't get worse. I just got run over by a truck. It can't get worse. I go and turn on TV, and the TV's talking about me and saying lies about me on TV. About me. I was on national TV. I went, I guess it can get worse. If you want to know the details about that, sometime I'll be glad to tell you. But it's Moses, the last step of surrender. He's a broken man taking care of someone else's sheep. And then he gets there to this burning bush. He discovers that God is there. And then he discovers who the living God is, which is really neat because God says, tells him who he is. He says, I know who you are. But before he introduces himself to him, he says, Moses, take off your shoes. This is holy. I mean, you think you're low when you're taking care of someone else's sheep. But God says, no, 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 you're not low enough. There's not that much leather you need to get up. I want you grounded, boy. Grounded. Oh, and that staff. Your occupation, your protection, your provision, your security. Throw it down. Wow! And what that represents is a total brokenness. Now, I've had experiences. I was in Sedona one time, and whoever made the sidewalks there thought it'd be great to get the sharpest rocks and put it as a sidewalk in concrete. But this guy, who never goes barefoot ever, I was born with shoes on. I had tender feet, and walking on that sidewalk, I'm like, man, what do they do? Put glass in there? Because to take off my shoes and walk on hard soil. Even someone who goes barefoot a lot can get used to that. But when you're really broken, and I remember at another church when things were falling apart, and I was struggling. There were gangs were tearing down the place gates, anything we did, anything, it was falling apart. And I'm feeling worthless. I'd spent a year on doctoral studies on how to grow a church, and I was growing it down. And I'm sitting there going, what's going on? God, I'm preaching Jesus. What's going on? I felt so broken, and I remember feeling so worthless as a pastor. And I know it's a bad habit. And I was walking to my car from the church office and just bemoaning to God how I just could not do anything right. And I spit. Bad habit, don't do that. And when I spit, the wind blew it and landed on my leg. I can almost cry today because of it. Because see, one thing I've discovered is when you've been that low, you don't get rid of the emotions. And I thought, I can't even spit and hit the ground. Moses was so broken, even when God said, I'm going to send you. Me? I can't get even up, God. What do you mean? Going to Mexico one time, and I'm going to be with this missionary all summer, 3 months for the summer. I'm leaving my girlfriend by herself with this guy that was courting her, and I didn't trust him. I go, oh, Jesus, you're going to guard my woman, you know. And I told Paul Kirsten, hey, guard my woman. He did do such a good job. And I just come to Mexico, and I said, what can I do just to have hope? I went and bought some sweet tarts one day for the entire summer just to help me have one piece of reminder home. I know it's just dumb sweet tarts, candy, just, you know, those big old rolls. And so I had them hidden, and that was what I looked for every day. One day I'd be going home. I sleep in the back of the pickup truck. It had a camper, no windows, dust. I was putting my clothes in a trash bag, a Glad trash bag, just to keep the dust off. I was serving Jesus. And the only thing I had as an encouragement were those sweet tarts. One a day. But my plans of one a day were spoiled when all the Mexican kids noticed I had candy. They didn't understand that this was my refuge to get me through. And it's like, God, do I have to give up my candy? I know it's candy, and I know you're poo-pooing me right now. I go, you so I had a mattress in the back of that pickup truck that was my bed that I slept on. And some little kid peed on it. Now, really? Shouldn't I just give up all my underwear too? Listen, church, sometimes we gotta go through brokenness and surrender, and God says, Moses, for you to be used, I know you're hurting, but you need to go all the way down. All the way down. And Moses took off his shoes and he experienced holy ground. I don't want you to come to church and maybe there's some barrier, something, some business, something that's keeping you from taking off your shoes and experiencing holy ground, because I'm convinced when you take that one step of surrender, that's when you have that revelation. And when you have that revelation, then you can be transformed. I am willing to die for Jesus because he has revealed himself to me. I don't need an archaeologist to prove something. I don't need a theologian to prove anything. You don't have to prove nothing to me because God has shown himself to me. And I know that I know that I know. And I'm praying that my kids get this revelation. And I pray that every church with every Christian, all our kids get a revelation that there is a God, and that they don't care how long you preach or how born yet Jesus is speaking. And he's got a plan. He's got a purpose. I mean, the stuff that you're going through. I felt so insecure as a young kid when I was your age and they preached those spiritual gifts. I thought I was the exception. I didn't have a spiritual gift. That applies to everybody else, but not me, because I felt insecure. Let me tell you something. It's when you get that revelation and God speaks to you, you go, oh man, that's what I want. Now let me just, I'll try to do this real quick. It's all about the cross. Everything is about the cross. You know, there is no other way to heaven. It's the cross. It's only through the cross of Jesus Christ. And God has had this plan from the very beginning, and he's entrusted the church with this message. So that when Jesus showed up, he revealed to us that he came to destroy every barrier between us and God. See, he made us in fellowship with him. Right? We were meant, we were clothed with the radiance of his glory. And then when sin came in, that glory disappeared, and then we realized our nakedness. And we died spiritually. The whole goal of Christianity is get us back to the garden. But there's a problem because there's a barrier between us and that entrance into the garden. It came about because of our sin. So Jesus, the solution, God's solution, was Al-Tah, God on the cross. That's God's solution. God is going to pay a price that we cannot pay. God made a covenant. The covenant is fulfilled in the cross, where he branches the old covenant and the new covenant. That Jesus began to teach, I am going to go into Jerusalem. I am going to be arrested. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to be rejected. And then they're going to kill me. It's all about the cross. That's why Jesus was born. His birth was to die on the cross. Before the foundations of the earth, before the foundations, did you hear that? Before the foundations of the earth, the Lamb of God was slain. All of God, God on the cross. It's the purpose of God that is fulfilled and culminated, and you and I are this sign looking back at the fulfillment, and we're about ready to watch the fruit of it. Oh, this is an exciting time to live. It says in Colossians 2:14, this is why he did it. Having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us, he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. You know what he did? The cross is where he took the condemnation and everything that you have done to separate yourself from God, and he nailed it to the cross. Those nails weren't there to hold him on there. Those nails were there to hold your judgment on. He knelt it. That's why he came. Because there was a barrier between you and God, and he wanted to wash that away. To take that away. The guilt, the condemnation, the judgment against us. Look what it says in Hebrews 10. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. That's what Jesus Christ has done for us. He inaugurated a new way. Now, I want you to picture this, because this is what he's talking about. He's talking about going through the veil. The veil is the barrier between us and God, the presence of God in the temple, which is the Holy of Holies. So the Holy of Holies represents the presence of God, where the Spirit of God dwells. The Ark of the Covenant is there. His presence is above the Ark, between the cherubim. But you can't get there. Only a priest can go there once a year. And there's a gigantic barrier, a veil, between us and God. Well, between the priest and God. 5 inches thick. And then only a priest can go in the holy place, and there's another veil. And then you and I are locked out, and it keeps the people away, the Nicanor gate, the exterior barrier. And there's all these barriers, and Jesus wants to break those down. But where did those barriers come from? The barriers came when God said, okay, you have sinned, get out of the garden. And then what did he do? He posted cherubim on the east side of the garden. This is the east side. He posted cherubim with a flaming sword to guard the path lest we go and eat of the tree of life. Because he did not want us to live eternally in a simple condition. So he kicked us out of the garden. And now if you wanted to get back to the Garden of Eden, the word for station is Shekinah comes from that word. It represents his presence. The word Shekinah is his presence, the dwelling, to dwell. It also means to tabernacle. And in fact, the word for tabernacle is Mishkan. And Mishkan is the noun, and is the place of God's dwelling. So when God built the tabernacle is a blueprint of the Garden of Eden. The presence of God is in the garden. On the east side is these cherubims. That's the entrance with a flaming sword. And then, and if you want to come, you have to deal with them. So when they built the tabernacle, the doors of the tabernacle are on the east side. You have to be coming from the east to go in. And then when you get there, you see trees, because there's trees that decorate, carved into the tabernacle, into the temple. And then you'll see cherubim lining the wall. And on those two curtains, between the Holy of Holies and the holy place, are cherubim. The barrier. You see the picture of the Garden of Eden in the tabernacle to go into the presence of God. But what's interesting is Moses. Moses is on the west side of the wilderness, broken down, coming from the east, and he comes to the mountain of God, Horeb. And when he gets to Horeb, he sees a burning bush. It's not extinguished, and he meets God, and he discovers holy ground. What's interesting is, the word Horeb means sword. The word says the two angels will tabernacle there on the east side of the Garden of Eden with a Horeb, a sword, a flaming sword. And now on Mount Horeb, which comes from the word for sword, you see a burning bush. And God says, this is going to be a sign, a sign. See, God's got a purpose. You'll bring the people back to Mount Horeb, and you're going to make a covenant with me. The Mountain of Covenant. We call it Mount Sinai, okay, because it's the wilderness of Sinai. But the mountain in the wilderness of Sinai, Mount Sinai, is called Horeb, a sword. And when the children of Israel finally come with Moses, they come to Mount Horeb, and when the presence, the Shekinah of God, comes on that mountain, it comes on fire. And they see that. Do you see the symbolism? God's purpose. He tells them, now build that tabernacle. And when you build the tabernacle, it's got to face east, and you've got to have cherubim on it, and you've got to have a barrier, and my presence is on the inside. It's all a blueprint, following the blueprint set in place by the purpose of God. And then Jesus finally comes and he fulfills the covenant. And when he dies on the cross, that curtain is ripped in two. And he's made a way for us. He dealt with those cherubim with a flaming sword. And he says, now we can get back to the paradise of God. We can get back to Eden. Now we can get back to where we came from. It's all about going home. The whole story is about getting back to the garden. And God wants to live in fellowship with us in the Garden of Eden. God wants us to dwell with him. They covered with his glory, the Shekinah glory of God. It's interesting because sometimes it was so funny because Moses, when the glory of God would fall on the tent of meeting, it felt so heavy that he had to get out. When Solomon dedicated the temple and they started doing it and they were doing sacrifices, the presence of God came and all the priests had to get out. Get out! Why? God's there. It's interesting. How, when the glory of God shows up, I mean, Isaiah sees the glory of God in the vision, and everything's shaking. He's going, he goes, woe is me, from a man with unclean lips. He saw the glory of God. The Apostle Paul, his eyes were blinded. His eyes were opened, and he became blind. Is that right? And he fell to his face as he saw the glory of God. And what God is saying now is my covenant is for you to get back to living in my glory. So you don't have to hide your eyes. You're not going to go blind. You don't have to veil because you are made to live in my glory. That's what the whole message is of the scripture. John 1:14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory of his own, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. We see the glory of God in him, but the Word for dwelt among us. Jesus is the Word of God that became flesh. And dwelt is tabernacle. And then we discovered in Revelations that Jesus is the tabernacle. He is the temple. He is the presence of God. It says in Revelations, it says, behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. Revelation 22, then he showed me a river, the river of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and in the middle of its streets. And on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit. Let me tell you something. When Jesus Christ died on the cross and said it is finished, the veil of the temple ripped in two, and the path has been made so that we can go back into the presence of God. And you and I are called to live in the Holy of Holies. You and I are called to live in the glory in the garden. The very name Eden means pleasure in the Hebrew, but its Greek equivalent is paradisos, which means paradise. Actually, in the Greek, if you study it out, for you hunters, it means a closed-in garden where there's a lot of game to hunt. That's the Greek mindset. But it's a closed-in garden, and it means paradise. So that when Jesus is dying on a cross, he's nailed on a cross between two thieves, and both are cursing him and mocking him, just like everybody else was. But then one of them came to his senses, and he told the other thief, he says, Stop it. Listen to what he says. He says, and indeed, we are suffering justly, for we are receiving what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he was saying, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he said to him, truly I say to you, today you shall be with me. Where? In paradise. Paradise is Eden. It's all about getting back into fellowship with God. Heaven is dwelling in the presence of God. Today, you will be with me in paradise. That's what the whole gospel message is all about. Now, I know there's a preacher by the name of Alistair Begg, and he has a cute rendition of this. If you know Frank Stevenson, he can give it to you. He showed it to everybody. And I think it's awesome. Because Alistair Begg says, I really want to ask this thief on the cross something. Because think about it. Here's this guy who's been a thief. He's getting what he deserves. He even says, you know what, we're being killed with the same judgment as Jesus, but we deserve it. I mean, that's taking off your sandals. I deserve it. I deserve what I'm getting. But then he begs for mercy. He says, Jesus, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. And Alistair Begg says, well, it's, I want to ask him, he says, what is it with you? I mean, how did you get here? I mean, because he never was baptized. I mean, he never went to church. He had no understanding of all maybe the spiritual laws. He probably didn't know the spiritual laws. I mean, I wonder, did he really know Jesus' name? I mean, did he? I mean, he probably did. Someone was saying it, I'm sure, but Alistair Begg says, I wonder what the angel said when the guy shows up at the pearly gates. He says, what are you doing here? We don't know you. He goes, I'm here. I was just told to come. He said, well, what have you done? You don't go to church? You haven't done anything? You haven't been baptized? Why would we let you in here? I need to get a supervisor. And the supervisor comes out and says, well, what is this? He says, look, let me ask you a couple questions. Tell me what your understanding is of the doctrine of being justified by grace. The guy goes, I don't know what you're talking about. Well, you tell me what your theology is on the scripture, the word of God. What do you believe about that? The guy goes, I don't know. He goes, well, then by what reason do you expect to let you in here? He goes, all I know is the guy on the middle cross said I could come. Let me tell you something. Jesus knocked the gates of hell off their hinges and says to anyone who will believe, you can come. He destroyed the veil 5 inches thick and ripped it in two, top to bottom. Rabbis teach that during the same time period, the veil or the doors in the temple to the holy place began to open up, and they could not close them and keep them closed. And the Nicanor gates that kept everybody out on the outside took 30 minutes, 20 men to open them up, opened up by themselves. Let me tell you something. If God opened up every door and made a way for anybody who believes, how can the church have the audacity to put up a barrier and a requirement? My prayer is, would we simply take the gospel message to this world and say, anybody who believes he gives a right to become children of God? And if someone says, who says you could come? Just say the guy on the middle cross. He said, I can. Would you bow your heads and let's pray? Oh, Jesus, you're so awesome. Oh, Lord, you are so good. Oh, you're so loving, so gracious, so kind, so merciful. Oh, and then you fulfilled it. You called it from the beginning. Gosh. Fourth word in the first verse of the Bible has the on top right there. It's the center of the first verse where you declare from the beginning that the Son of God would die on the cross. And it's been a covenant marker from there on. And you did it. Lord, when we go through times of trial and tribulation and we're hurting, and it's been a long time, some of us have been struggling with some of our challenges for years and years and years and years, of the sleepless nights and the torment and the crying out and the unanswered prayers. Lord God, and yet we know that's the same kind of thing that people like Moses and David endured, and Abraham and Daniel was told, you're not going to see this happen in your day, but don't worry. We'll wake you up in time to see the end. Help us, Lord God, to trust, to believe, and realize you're doing something. There's a purpose and a plan. even in the smallest details. You told us, you know, the number of hairs on her head. You don't count them because there's not a reason. Help us to realize that we're part of a powerful, awesome, glorious plan. And we're not part of it because we're glorious and awesome in ourselves, but because we serve an awesome and glorious God who created us for a purpose and has a plan. How awesome is our God? We humble ourselves before you. And we pray that you would do a work in and through us that would bring you glory, and that we would honor you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, church, I don't know about you, but sometimes I just get excited about the simple gospel, the plan of Jesus on that cross. It's kind of like before the creation of anything, he goes, there's a target, a bullseye, it's going to be about a billion years from here, watch me hit it. And we're on the other side watching him, and he did it at the right time. Jesus Christ was crucified at the right second. And we're on the other side going, what's for lunch? Okay. We're going to tell you what, since we go long today, we're going to feed you. We're going to feed you the Lord's Supper. Let me tell you something. This is the covenant. That covenant I told you about before the foundations of the earth, Jesus being crucified and his plan being fulfilled in the cross. And then he opens it up to everyone. And right now, he knows about you being here and he wants you to receive his covenant. This is the meal of the covenant where you get to say, I do, because he already said, I do to you. He already knew you before you were born. And he just wants you to have the light turned on and for you to say yes to him. So we're inviting you to come today. We have to confess that none of us in ourselves. And we're like the thief on the cross. I don't know nothing. I know nothing. I see nothing. I know. And like Moses, some of us got to take off our sandals. This is the time. So let's do that. Lord God, we confess. Lord, we have sinned and fallen short of being the people you call us to be, of doing the things you want us to do and having the attitudes of the heart that you want us to have. We fall short, Lord God. And even when we think that we haven't fallen short and that we've actually done good, even our best efforts fall short. Help us, Lord God, to realize how desperate we are for grace and mercy, and then to realize how full of grace and mercy you are to give it to us. So, Lord God, we lay ourselves before you. We open our hearts to you. And we pray that your glory would be accomplished in your church as we confess our sins and humble ourselves before you. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. Church, I want to tell you what we do here during the communion time. We celebrate God's gift for us. We want to remember what Jesus did for us on the night in which he was betrayed, when he took the bread and he gave thanks over the bread. And then he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, take and eat, for this is my body which is broken for you. Take it and eat it and do it in remembrance of me. This is a covenant which he's making with his bride, with his beloved. After supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks over the cup. And then he gave it to his disciples and he said, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of it, do it in remembrance of me until I come again. This is the cup of redemption, the cup of love and forgiveness. The cup that represented the shedding of his blood for us, because he loves you. And it's also now the cup of life, as you receive and are part of that covenant. Jesus invites us to come and receive his grace. For those who will be serving, come and prepare. Okay. Here you go. Mm-hmm. is the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, which is broken for you. The body of Christ, which is broken for you. Anybody come in? I appreciate it. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you.
This is the body of Christ broken for you.
Amen. It's the blood of Jesus which is shed for you. The blood of Jesus shed for you. The blood of Jesus Christ shed for you. The blood of Jesus shed for you. The blood of Jesus shed for you. Congregation, we're going to invite you to come and receive. But one thing I want you to hear. This is not grape juice and bread. This is covenant. The grape juice and the bread are symbols of that covenant. But it's the covenant that you're partaking. It's you saying, I'm part of what God has been doing. I'm saying yes to what God wants to do in me and through me. Through His brokenness, you're made whole. Through the shedding of His blood, you're washed clean. Today, this is a covenant, which I believe God is going to do and put on record. This is my child, receive it. Come and receive the gift of God. We have gluten-free elements here. If you like to receive gluten-free. And afterwards, I'll be over here to the side. If you need to be prayed for, I'll be glad to pray for you. Would you come and receive God's gift for you today?
I praise you again and again. 'Cause all I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but nothing else fit for a king, except for heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
And the people of God said,
amen.
You know, it was so cool, is that God told Moses, said, this is my memorial name, Yahweh or Jehovah, however you say that, the Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. And what's interesting is that there is a limitation of how much glory you can get from that interaction with Jehovah until Jehovah showed up in Jesus. Because Jesus is the door. Jesus is the entry. And so when you look at Jesus, that is the name of Jehovah with our salvation. That is the key. That's why there's salvation. No one else? It can't be. It's all about the cross of Jesus. And I'm worried about any church that doesn't preach somewhere, somehow, central. You believe in that? We're good. Baptize the way you want to baptize. Do the communion the way you want to do the communion. As long as Jesus Christ is central, dying on the cross.
Amen.
That is the foundation.
Amen.
That's the promise of God and the covenant God fulfilled. I'm going to ask you to stand and receive the blessing of Almighty God next week. We're going to do baptisms. We invite you to come, to celebrate with us. It sounds like a football stadium prayer. Have you heard those football prayers? Dear Lord, we ask you, bless. Okay, so next week, come and we're going to celebrate with our family their baptisms. If you see the trough and get so inspired, they want to be prepared, you just let me know during the week. Otherwise, we're going to do 4 baptisms and 1 reaffirmation of a baptism of the entire family.
Hallelujah.
It's going to be a good day. Bring a towel. Sit close. Okay.
Amen.
Receive the blessing of God. May the grace, the peace, the power, the anointing, the glory, the goodness of the living God be upon you. May you walk in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And may God do great and glorious things through you. And may you realize it goes beyond you and beyond this life into life eternal. And one day, you and I, we're going to bow down together and say, God, you are so good, so good, so awesome. Thank you for allowing those things that I went through to be done in my life so that I can be where I'm at. Because you have made awesome, glorious things out of me. You are blessed. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.